Well, I was really very pleased when I first heard that we were going to have bloodless medicine and surgery here. It's clearly increased the quality of our transfusion service in the hospital by making it more complete. When we go to a patient here, and if that person has, for religious reasons, for scientific reasons, for whatever reason, a preference not to receive blood, we now have a team of informed professionals who can deal with that. It's greatly improved the way that we can approach the community and say, come on in, we've got people who think the way you think. When I was trained, and that was back in the 50s and the 60s, we would transfuse at this level here. Someone came down to here, you had to be transfused. That number was probably, let's say, 10 grams per deciliter, 10. There's a person right in the hospital now. Her hemoglobin is below 6, and we're having a great difficulty matching her. Years ago, if she was at 6, that's a lot less than 10, we probably would have felt compelled to transfuse her with blood that wasn't perfectly matched. I saw her last night, I saw her early this morning, she's fine. And I've learned to be comfortable with that, that you don't have to transfuse here. You can go down here, you can go down here. In fact, you can just not transfuse. You have to balance the seriousness of complications of a blood transfusion with the transitory benefit of raising the hemoglobin over a few days. When a complication from blood does happen, it's potentially pretty serious, a life-threatening complication, or maybe a lifelong infection. You can't get a complication from a blood transfusion if you didn't get one. That is a very key part of this new focus. I'm relying on my older colleagues to convey to my younger colleagues the reality of their experience of having given a unit of blood that caused, maybe it was HIV, maybe it was hepatitis C, and then questioning, did I really need to give Mrs. Smith that unit of blood that's caused her to have this complication? I've had open heart surgery, and I was faced with, do I want to get someone else's blood if I don't really, really need it? And when it really came to me, do I want to get someone else's blood? Only unless I'm as white as my white lab coat would I want to get a transfusion. Only if I was in a life-threatening situation. None of us want to give a unit of blood that's not necessary, because if it's not going to make things better, and it could make things worse, that's not good medicine. So it's the drive to do the best medicine that's possible with the least amount of blood that's possible.